So good evening, everyone. And we have Dr. Deepak Veerappan. He's a hepatologist from Chennai, India, with interest in ecology, evolution, systematics, natural history, and biography. He is currently a scientific associate at the Natural History Museum in London and a National Geographic Explorer. Deepak has been involved in scientific research in South Asia for the last 15 years, focusing on herpetofauna. He started his research on lizards in the Western Ghats in 2004 and continued to work in Ghats on the ecology and behavior of tortoises for his PhD. His own surveys across India as part of his first postdoc, along with cooperative work, led to the discovery of 25 new species of reptiles and recognition of new subfamily of snakes. I think the number is keep on increasing, I think, discovery of new species for him. And Deepak is committed to conservation of herpetofauna and their habitats, and he contributes scientific data for IUCN Red List assessments. We are Living Earth is happy to welcome Dr. Deepak Veerappan for this Living Earth webinar. The panel is yours, Deepak.
Thank you, Ratish. Can you all hear me?
Yeah, we can. Yeah. Yes, loud and clear.
Okay. So, hello, everyone. It's nice seeing you all. And before I actually go into the talk, I'd really like to thank Ratish and Subish for organizing these talks in general. It's very informative for covering various topics, and I know them for many years now, and they're doing regional conservation work, and I really appreciate that, and I really like regional conservation work. So today I'm going to talk about the two endemic turtles, as the title says, from Western Ghats, for which on which I did my PhD, one of them, the Travancore tortoise, I did my PhD. So before I talk about these two turtles, why should we care about turtles? It's the first question. So they are critical in an environment. They play a very critical role. Some of them are seed dispersers, freshwater turtles. They are scavengers, and they also feed on aquatic vegetation. So because of this, they maintain a healthy river system. And they are also one of the oldest lineage of vertebrates in the world. Their turtle lineage is about 220 million years old. So that's another reason for us to conserve them. And last but not the least is the past and present interrelationship between human culture and animals, especially in Asia, in India, Hinduism, we revere them, turtles as gods. And in northeastern India, there was one species of turtle, Nelsonia nigrescens. People thought it was extinct for a long time, but then they found them in various temple ponds. So people were conserving them. Like, although various parts of eastern India, they were being hunted or poached and eaten, some places people did not kill them, and they were still alive. So that's why we should care about turtles. So there are 29 species of turtles, freshwater turtles and tortoises. I'm not talking about the sea turtles. There are 29 species in India, of which 7 species are found in peninsular India. So here you see 5 of them. The first one is a flap-shell turtle. So I put 2 pictures of this species. So you can see the ventral side. So they have a flap in which they can close. They can pull in their legs and they can close the flaps. So that's why they're called flap-shell turtles. It's a very common species found across India and also found in peninsular India. You find the black pond turtle, the Indian black pond turtle. It's also very common, Melanochelys strigica. Then at the bottom left, you see Vijaycelys selvatica, which is a relatively rare species. I'll talk about that in a bit. So we have 2 large riverine turtles in peninsular India. We have the Pilocelys cantarei, which can grow up to 1 meter long. And then we have Nelsonia lethi, which is endemic to peninsular India. And these are found in large river systems. They are not found in small ponds or lakes. In some big lakes, they are found, but mostly these are associated with large river systems. Then we have, out of the 7 freshwater turtles and tortoises, then we have 2 tortoises. So we have the star tortoise, which most of us might be familiar with. They're often surfacing on news channels, like people are poaching them in huge numbers and trying to smuggle them out of the country. So you find them in dry deciduous and dry forests. scrub forest, dry scrub forest across the India, peninsular India, and also you find them in northern India to some extent in Rajasthan and all. Then you have Travancore tortoise, which is also endemic to the Western Ghats. And not many people might have seen this species, mainly because of their secretive behavior, and I'll talk about it in a bit. So why, how, where are these Travancore tortoise found? So even within the Western Ghats, their distribution is a bit restricted. They're only found 16 degrees north latitude, up to that. So they're not found beyond that in these three states, mostly in Kerala, and to some extent in Karnataka, and some parts of Tamil Nadu also you find them. So Bullinger, in 1907, he described the species from Western Ghats. And since its description, around 6 decades, nobody reported this. And only after that, there were more records of the species from Western Ghats. And the next species is the cane turtle, which is also endemic to Western Ghats, which has very similar distribution pattern. But Travancore tortoise are found not just in evergreen forest, they are also found in deciduous, moist deciduous forest and the secondary forest in the Western Ghats. But cane turtles are restricted to evergreen forest, although the distribution pattern looks very similar. So these turtles were described in 1912 by Henderson. And again, for 6 decades, there was no record of the species until late J. Vijaya. She rediscovered the species in the Cochin Forest. And since then, there's been more reports of the species in the Western Ghats. So to understand the actual distribution pattern of the species, we should also understand the rainfall pattern in India. So as many of us know, the rainfall is higher in northeastern India and the Western Ghats, which are also the biodiversity hotspots. And these two species of turtles are found in the western slopes of Western Ghats, where there's more rainfall, but not on the eastern slopes. So the map you see here is the study area of where I did my research for 5 years, from 2006 to 2010, as a researcher from WII, then a researcher from WII, in these two tiger reserves, in Parambikulam and Annamalai Tiger Reserve. And I want you to look at a few things. So one is the elevation gradient. You can see all the darker regions are higher elevation. And turtles in general, they're not found in higher elevation. And cane turtle and Travancore tortoise in particular, they're not found beyond 900 meter elevation. So even though this whole area put together was about 1,200 square kilometer, Annamalai and Parambikulam, only a small area, most of Parambikulam, which is about 270 square kilometer, and some regions adjacent to Parambikulam, this part where I'm showing in my mouse, is where our potential habitat for Travancore tortoise and cane turtle. So there are also these areas, but then which are in the lower potential elevation of cane and Travancore tortoise, but then it's on the eastern slope. So that's in Amravati and Chinnar area. So you get star tortoise there because the habitat is completely different and the rainfall is really poor. So this is not potential habitat. So what we are left for Travancore tortoise is only these areas. So, and then what you see here in this white square is the mapped telemetry study area. I'll talk about it in detail in a bit. One more thing I want you to notice is this area, although it's again, though it's big, it's also in the 1950s, there's a lot of interconnected dams built in this area. So reservoirs, there are large reservoirs. So even though the area is relatively big, large parts of these areas are submerged underwater. So to give you an idea about the overall habitat of the Annamalai area, so the first picture you see is from Karimala Peak, which is one of the highest peak in Parambikulam, and you can see the Parambikulam reservoir. So there's a lot of man-made islands and a huge reservoir which is submerged, I don't know how many hectares of forest. And on the right you see a nice riparian forest, so you have that, and these are the dam side habitats. So it's nice and green now, but if you go in summer, it's all like leafless. So it's mainly because this area also is area where there were a lot of silvicultural practices. So there were a lot of monocultures, several hectares of teak plantation planted there during the British era. And now they are regenerating with the natural vegetation, but still its majority, these mid elevations are covered with plantations. And on the right, you see these open habitats. There's a lot of patchy evergreen forest you can see on the mountain, towards the mountain. And then the lower parts, you see moist, testiest forest. So first, I'll talk about the Travancore tortoise. I already gave a brief description of their distribution and where their habitat type. But then that's very secondary information, which is available for many species of reptiles in India. Oh, they are found in this kind of habitat. They're found in Western Ghats. But then what do they do? How do they live? And these were the questions nobody answered until I had a chance to go and answer this question and try to find an answer to these questions. So first of all, so as Ratish introduced, I'm from Chennai. So I've never been out of Chennai till my undergrad. And I didn't know how to find a tortoise until then. So it took almost 4 months, even with local assistant, to find the first Travancore tortoise. So they are big, relatively big tortoise. They can grow up to 33 centimeters. But then it was not an easy task to find them. So over the years with local expertise, we managed to find out that they leave trail marks when they are walking in grassy patches where they are foraging. And they also leave spore marks. Basically, when they are walking, the impression of the nails are there on these small swampy areas. So based on that, you can find them. So we also use that as an indirect evidence for the presence of these tortoises in the habitat. So that's a zoomed in version of the study area. So as I said earlier, that's the potential habitat for the Travancore tortoise. So I want you to focus on the circles or the trails, the starting point of these trails, which I marked. So we marked 2 kilometer forest trails in this 450 square kilometer area. And we did 340 surveys across these years. So we walked these trails repeatedly and to find tortoises. So another thing I want you to see on this map is the orange triangles. They are basically hamlets or settlements of three different types of tribes who live in these areas. So they are all settled in this particular part. And the reservoirs here are marked in blue. So over the years, we found some tortoises, around 77 tortoises from all these trail sampling. And you can see in 2008, we hardly found any tortoises, but then we found a lot of indirect evidence during these 2007-2008. And that helped us to understand the status of the species or find out what is going on with this population. So in order to, like, for tigers, they do all India census, like what is the status of the tiger. But for tortoises, since it is difficult to find, so we had to find other ways of estimating the abundance. So one way of looking at it is checking for that is occupancy surveys. So when I was doing these surveys, I also collected a lot of secondary covariates, basically. What is the level of disturbance? How much there is lopping? How much trails are passing through, which are regularly used by people? What is the kind of vegetation? What is the number of extent of grass marshes within these trails? And so on and so forth. So I won't go in detail on this. You forget all the numbers there and whatnot. But the whole gist of this is that after doing surveys for 4 years, we found out that disturbance, if the trails are disturbed more, there is a chance the tortoise, you don't find the tortoise. There's a higher chance you find the tortoise when the disturbance level is low. And then on the right side, if you want to detect a tortoise in a forest like this, one of the main places you have to be looking at is near water bodies. And if there are more number of water bodies in this trail, there's a more chance of finding tortoises and also the extent of the grass marshes. So this is a based on the 4 years of surveys on these trails, those 320 surveys. So it was interesting, but then we wanted to find out more, like why we find more tortoises near water bodies and grass marshes, like what are they doing day to day. So for that, we did this telemetry study. So telemetry is quite straightforward. This is a radio telemetry study. So I had an antenna, which looked like a TV antenna at that time. Now I went to field with some friends. They have a really handy small antenna. But that time we had to carry this massive thing and walk around in the forest. And you have a receiver. And then you see what these things are on the back of the tortoise and the turtle is the transmitter. You put the transmitter, you walk in the forest every day with the antenna, try to locate the animal, get a location of that animal, come back and map it. So that's what I did for 4 years. So in the first map I showed you, in the study area map, I showed you the small white square. It's the intensively monitored radio telemetry area, which is bordering Annamalai and Parambikulam Tiger Reserve. So we mapped 110 hectare study area. So here I meant I mapped in the sense I have literally mapped every 20 meters, we measured them and mapped the area. So GPS was there at that time, but it was inside the forest. The accuracy was not great. So we, in order to understand fine scale movement pattern and distribution and behavior of tortoises, we did an intensive mapping of the study area. So once I did the mapping, so that's what I mentioned earlier. So we had a stake and I had this device called a clinometer. So you take the angle of the terrain. So you also map the terrain, like what is the elevation and whatnot. And also what and all physical structures are present, like how many boulders were there, what are the fallen vegetation in the fallen trees, what is the number of big trees in this 110 hectare. So basically everything in that habitat, more or less. So at that time, I did not have a computer. So whenever I got back to my base camp, so I had this chart and I had drawn these grids. So every day when I map each grid, I used to go and put a given number for each of these corners. And I used to map the movement of these turtles. And then a few years later, I got a computer. Then there's a finished map you see on the right. That's the, so two things I want you to focus here. So one is the dark gray area is the evergreen forest. Number two is the spotted areas, which is the bamboo and lantana forest. There are only two types of habitats in this study area. And then there was a perennial river, and then there were smaller rivers which were not perennial but active when there's monsoon. And then there's a road. There's also this trail which goes, it's a trekking trail basically in the forest, but it's heavily used. So that's the mapped 110 hectare study area. So within each of these 100 by 100 meter squares, we also collected micro habitat data. So how much leaf litter is there? What is the amount of fallen logs and the number of rocks and so on to see how, what is affecting the movement of these tortoises within the study area. So what you see on the left is the same grid. But then I've removed 9 of those grids because none of the 7 tortoises which we tried to track for over 5 years cross these trails. So these are disturbed patches. They never moved across this patch. And so when I'm doing analysis, I can't use it. So I just got rid of it. But what is interesting is that the very dark gray areas in this figure means there is a higher chance you will find a Travancore tortoise. And the lighter areas means there's a less chance you'll find the Travancore tortoise. So in a sense, like Travancore tortoise are mostly using areas which are edge habitat between evergreen forest and bamboo lantana forest. So on the right is a picture from my study area. So you can see the bamboo lantana forest in the front. And in the back, you can see the evergreen forest. So, and when I got these points and then tried to put it in, calculate it in distance, like how far they are away from these forest edges. So most of them, the locations in the number of days when the animals were found, they were found very close to the edge habitats. So that's interesting. But then why they are doing that? So To answer that, one of the primary reason may be because Travancore tortoises are primarily herbivores, which are often feeding on plant vegetation, so leaves, grass blades, herbs, sometimes fruits. But I also found a good number of animal remains in their fecal sample. So every individual I got, they defecate, collect the fecal sample, bring it back to the base camp, wash them and dry them and separate them into different prey remains. So these are things which I could see in the fecal sample, but then there are other things which might not show up in the fecal sample, like mushrooms. So the local communities have told me that Travancore tortoise, like whenever they go looking for mushrooms, they often see Travancore tortoise feeding on them. So these things does not show up in the fecal sample, but we did have direct observation. So another interesting story I'd like to share here is about Travancore tortoise, which we found in Parambikulam. This was in 2007, I guess. So me and my field assistants. So we did the surveys for Travancore tortoise in the evenings because that's when they are more active. They are crepuscular in activity. So we were doing our surveys and our local assistant warned, oh, there's a tiger kill nearby in the wild, so be careful. But and then our trail was passing right through that. So we were walking past and then we could hear something. And we could see in a distance there's also a movement, and that's where the stench of the tiger carcass is coming from. So my assistant were really worried that there could be a tiger there and it's moving. So we waited for quite some time, and then after a while I told them, like, look, the movement looks small and there's no growling, let's go investigate. So we went closer and then we found this Travancore tortoise nicely feasting on tiger kill. So that's a story, and it was very exciting story. I always like to share that. But the scientific point of view, if you look at it, so Travancore tortoises, when the small ones, the hatchling, are about 3.5 centimeters, and then they grow up to 33 centimeters, as I said. So by only eating grass, you can't grow. You can grow, but then you don't have enough nutrients to build a nice thick shell around you. So you need a lot more supplements. So that's why they're probably feeding on more animal material whenever they get a chance. So I've also seen skink scales, snake scales on their fecal samples. So it's a very interesting observation which we found. And so, yeah, they're primarily herbivores feeding on plants. And another interesting observation I would like to share, this is mainly possible because of the telemetry study we did. So I want you to look at this yellow thing I've attached to the tortoise on the back. So this is not the transmitter. So on Travancore tortoises, we attached a temperature logger. And temperature loggers, I could set it up at that time to collect temperature data in the surrounding every 1 hour. So Travancore tortoise has this habit of often burrowing under lantana bushes or going inside burrows or inside tree hollows. So this one led us to, this was a male, it led us to another female, which was also inside the same burrow. And one of my field assistants, Selamban, he's standing here. It's a huge tree. And we were again worried to go inside this tree because sometimes we heard sound. So we thought bears were actually using this. So we had to knock it before we enter the house. So we went in and then we saw these two tortoises. And so around the same time, we also put temperature loggers in the study area in these two different type of habitat to find out what's the temperature in the environment, and so that we can compare it with the temperature on the logger on the animal. So one of the tortoises, which I tracked, went inside a termite hill burrow. And it was inside the burrow for a long time, so for around 50 days. So initially, when it went inside the burrow, we had put these small sticks. So we would know that if the animal is coming out and going back inside, like if they're coming out at night, feeding and then going back. So it didn't happen. For 50 days, they did not come out. And for 100 days, again, it did not come out. So then we were getting suspicious. And my assistants are like, oh, what are we, like, maybe we are taking data on a dead animal. It's probably something, it's dead inside. So let's open it and see. So I was hesitant. So I, at that time, the person I know who had done field work and done a lot of studies in the 90s on Travancore tortoise is late Dr. Bhupathi. And I called him up and I told him, this is the case, like, what do I do? So he was like, we don't know anything about this turtle. Yeah, so I did a survey, but I didn't know. So just wait for a few more days. So we waited. And after 107 days, the tortoise came out of the burrow. And I was lucky. I got the temperature data. It was, logger was still working. So I got data for 100 days from the animal. But before I talk about that, so I want you to look at the graph on the left. It's the rainfall and temperature in the study area in 2009. So you can see that there was a huge fluctuation in temperature in the environment between January and June. But after the monsoons, the temperature fluctuation is more normal and less fluctuating. And on the right, you see the graph where I have plotted the temperature in the surrounding and the temperature on the animal, which is in red. So the temperature on logger on the animal is, or inside the burrow, the temperature was just 2 degrees or 2.5 degree fluctuation. So it was in a nice, like it's like in a nice air conditioned room. The animal was just sitting there. What it was doing, we don't know. Whether it fed on termites, maybe it did, but we don't know what it was doing. But it was there for 107 days inside that burrow, which was a very, very interesting observation. And nobody knew about what these things, or what these tortoises live in, they do in these burrows. So many of you might know, and you might have learned in biology lessons about endotherms and ectotherms. Endotherms are animals which can maintain their body temperature. Mammals, humans are one, birds. But then the ectotherms, invertebrates, all the reptiles and amphibians, they are all ectotherms. So which is, they have to depend on the environmental temperature. So you might have seen crocs and turtles in a river system around, or agamids in your garden. They come out in the morning, they stand on the bush, so they warm up, and then once they're warm enough, then they are more active, moving around, feeding on insects or whatever they feed on. So that's about a little bit of biology on thermoregulation for you. And Travancore tortoise is probably doing a behavioral thermoregulation to be functional in an environment like that. So the next species I'm going to talk about is the cane turtle. And this, as I said, is a very elusive species, and it's also endangered and rare species found only in the Western Ghats. So I want you to look at this picture, and in the chat box, if you can say if you find, if there is a tortoise, a turtle found in the same picture or not, can you type in the chat box, yes or no? I'll give a minute. I can see.
Okay. So urine is selling in the center.
Okay. All right. So most of you got it right. Yes, it's in the center. But it wasn't easy for me to find the first cane turtle. It took 6 months. And those 6 months, we were laying quadrants, 50 by 5 meter quadrants in the forest floor. And I was literally sweeping the forest floor with my assistant in the hopes to find one cane turtle. Given that they have so much lichen and the serration on the back, it looks more like a leaf on the forest floor. So among leaf litter, it's one of the most difficult species of turtles to find. So it took 6 months to find the first individual. So it's very, very interesting species. They are sexually dimorphic. Females are larger than males, but they're also sexually dichromatic. So males have these very bright coloration. They are white, red, yellow, and black, as you see in the figures on the left. And females are more drab, but they also have a little bit of pinkish coloration on the head. So what is their home range? Like, what do they do, like cane turtles? So there are small turtles. They grow up to like they can fit in your palm. So they have a small home range. So maximum, the biggest home range was 14 hectares and the smallest was around 5 hectares. And this estimation was based on this method called the minimum convex polygon. So basically, male one, if you see on the right, the plot. So you take the outermost points and then you put a line around it and then you calculate the area within it. But then there are other methods. Now I'm sure there are much more advanced methods, but there's another LCH method I did. So where it identifies hotspots within the home range where this animal is used, and based on that, it gives a more accurate estimate of the home range of these species. So if you compare that, it's relatively small home ranges of these turtles. But they are also interesting. They live in really high density. So within this 42 hectare plot, which I did the telemetry study, we found around 32 individuals. So they live in really high densities wherever they are living. Just that it's very difficult to find one. So how are they active? So what is their activity like? I told Travancore tortoise sometimes they go inside and they are not active for 100 days. So cane turtles, they don't use, like I have not seen them using burrows. They go inside fallen logs. They're often under leaf litter, hidden. But when are they active? So when I plotted the temperature, so for cane turtle, we did not put a temperature logger on their back of their carapace because it's too large and it will affect the animal movement. So every day when we went and looked for these tortoises or turtles, so we put a moved the temperature logger and it was on a small stick. So we moved every time the animal moved. And that's the temperature you see here. So the minimum temperature when the animal was active is around 17 degrees Celsius onwards till so beyond 17 degrees Celsius. And the maximum is around 30 degrees Celsius. So again, I'm going to introduce an interesting concept like for ectotherms and particularly in turtles in the late 50s and early 50s and late 40s, there were a lot of experiments which are a bit cruel, but they don't do that anymore. So they used to put turtles in chambers and they gradually increase or decrease the temperature to find out when the animal completely shuts down. They don't die, but they shut down. They stop, cease activity. So turtles at beyond one point, they stop activity. And if it is increased even 0.5 degrees beyond that or below that, they die. So these are called critical thermal maximum and critical thermal minimum. So probably cane turtle also, they naturally know when to stop their activity and when to be more active, because they have this temperature constraint in them. So I talked about Travancore tortoise's diet, but what do cane turtles feed on? So cane turtles are primarily insectivores or molluscivores. So they feed on mollusks, a lot of insects. I've also seen millipede remains in their diet. And sometimes we found plant material and a lot of sand in the fecal samples, but then that could be accidental ingestion because these are animals living on the forest floor, very wet environment. So things stick on the food, so they're eating that. So that's what we're getting. But then I would like to share a very interesting observation on this endemic snail and the cane turtle. There's this snail called Indrella ampulla. And whenever a predator tries to attack it, they release a mucus substance. And this mucus substance acts differently in different seasons. So when it's a dry season, when it's mixed with mud and the debris, they become a very sticky glue. And in a monsoon, in the wet season, when the mucus becomes very slippery. So an animal tries to grab it, so it becomes slippery. So I've seen these shells of snails in the fecal samples. And then I've seen one incident where there was a turtle on the forest floor and on like a meter away, there was a snail with full of frog and the turtle, which was completely stuck with the glue. At that time, I kind of hypothesized this, okay, this is probably what happened, but it was not until Later, one MSc student from Pondicherry, Utpal, he came and he did a behavioral study on king turtle, and he was there watching the turtle for continuously for a long time. And one day it rained, and there's this photograph which I've shown here. So this is the incident we saw, and he immediately called us up. I was at my base camp, so I came back. So for 20 minutes or so, the turtle was trying really hard to eat this snail, but it didn't manage for 20 minutes, but later it did. So it was slipping away. So that was probably the most exciting observation or activity which Utpal saw at that time, because most of the time he saw the animal sleeping or their head out, eyes open. So that's the kind of things he could record, because he was in a season when the animals are not that active. But even then, king turtles are not that active. They're very secretive and shy. So it was lucky we could record these very interesting behavior during this study. And it was only possible because of the telemetry study. So another interesting observation I would like to share about cane turtle natural history is male-male fighting. So Travancore tortoise also do a lot of male-male fight. So they hiss and they ram each other, males. But then cane turtle, they also bite each other. They hiss and ram, they also bite each other. So after 2010, after I finished my fieldwork, I went to the US in Florida, where I made a presentation on these turtle study. And I had a chance to meet late Dr. Peter Pritchard. So, and I shared this observation with him, like there was this fighting, male-male fighting. What do you think? And I also had found like broken shells or carapace of these turtles. And he said he had observed this in not the behavior, because the animal is extinct. He found this damage on the shell in extinct species from Mauritius. So then immediately after I came back from the US, so I had data on every single shell of the or the scute of the cane turtle, because it was so rare, I didn't want to miss any information. So I used to collect a very meticulous, detailed information on the shell. Then I found out like 50% of the male, almost 50% of the male cane turtle I found had a damage on their nuchal scute. And no females or juvenile individuals had this damage. And then we hypothesized that it is definitely because male-male fight. It's a very simple and interesting observation, but it took only 4 years to prove it, that this is what is happening. So I told you it took 6 months to find the first cane turtle, but then we got better at finding cane turtles over the years. So in the third year, me and my assistant Silamban, so we found 8 individuals. So he found 3 and I found 5 individuals within an hour and a half of walking around in the forest. And that was the most individual I found in any given day. But then other times I've seen 3 or 4, but that's the most. So is it just luck that day, or is it detectability? So I think it's a bit of both. It's as you keep looking for something over the years, so you also get better at spotting them, but it's also a little bit of luck. So to sum it up, from my PhD study, one of my chapters from my PhD study was a conservation action plan for Travancore tortoise. But later I also did one for cane turtle, and we submitted to the department. So long-term monitoring of populations of Travancore tortoise is very important, because we won't know what is happening. So it looks like they are affected by the disturbance in their habitat, and maybe they are gradually disappearing. And unless we monitor them regularly, we won't know. So wires and grasslands are important habitats for Travancore tortoise in this study area. And we need more awareness of the threatened status and importance of tortoise and turtles, particularly these two species in that region and across its range in the Western Ghat. And hunting for meat in other areas in Valachal and Olchalakudi, this reported for both cane turtle and Travancore tortoise. They are hunted for meat. They're not poached, they're hunted. But still, if large individuals from a populations are removed over time, it's going to affect the population really bad. And at the end, we might not see these species in the field anymore. So I would like to thank many people, but then two people who helped me a lot is Sandeep, who had been throughout the surveys in the Western Ghats. So not during the project, but in 2010, we did a Reiki survey across the Western Ghats looking for these two turtles for 3-4 months. And Sandeep was there for half of it. And Shruti was doing a project on the wires. So what grass and sedge and herbs are found in these wires so that I could match these. So she identified many. So I could match these species from the fecal sample, if the remains, what and all species I could, what and all species of plants these tortoises are feeding on. So I'd like to thank them. So, and then over the years, I also realized that it's how important native communities and forest departments play a role, like almost 6-7 decades. This wonderful habitat with so many beautiful species has been conserved, and it's not possible without their active conservation actions in the field. And we could go there and see them in the field. There are plenty of people to acknowledge, Forest Department, particularly Kerala and Tamil Nadu Forest Department for the permits, WII for the funding and support, funding from the Ministry of Environment and Forest, and WII for supporting my study, and a lot of people over the years have helped me. So if you want to follow my work, you could find in Twitter or social media, you could write to me in email if you find any turtles, if you want identification. And most of these results are published, and you could get my follow me in ResearchGate, and you will get most of these publications there. And thank you very much for your time and listening to me. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Deepak. It was a very good presentation. I have a few questions. Like, you didn't talk about the breeding behavior of this king turtle and this Travancore. Can you?
Okay, so I've seen them mating of Travancore tortoise and cane turtle also, but I've never seen their egg in the field. Okay. Over the years, I did not see them.
So you don't know like where they will breed and where they...
So based on local native people observation, so they said they don't dig a big hole. They just make a small depression, and then they lay the egg and they cover it with leaf litter is what I've heard. But I did not see them.
Okay, sure. So the next question is from Satyanarayana.
Okay.
Professor Satyanarayana, ABC.
Okay.
Hi.
Hello, sir.
Hi, Deepak.
Okay. I'm good, thank you.
I'll read out the question. Based on undigested hard parts of insects identified, if so, which is the preferred insect species, like food item?
I mean, I don't know. So all we know is that it's feeding on insects and also scorpions. And it's most likely because for the calcium, so that they get more additional calcium in their diet, most likely. But then I couldn't identify many at a species level. I just categorize them into animal and plant material, and within animal, there's insects, there are vertebrate remains in some cases, hair in some cases, like sambar deer, or there was also a small Indian civet hair. And some people in WI were able to identify them because they could check the hair and identify it from. Yeah, thanks.
If you allow me just to have some more clarification on just one thing is, when I'm doing for my Indian blue peafowl feeding habit, we collect the droppings, dried it, and segregate all those things. I had a lot of insect hard parts, undigested insect part. When we have that, very, very interesting thing is component of species, the black ant. So mostly it preferred black ant because of feeding strategy. So that's what I want interested. The founder definitely helped me very good. If we have already collected dried feeding, the pellets or droppings of the turtle, you can also identify the insect part, whichever, that will give you a very good idea. And one more thing, is seed identification is a difficult task, because I came to know from most of the people, it's a very, very difficult task, identify seeds.
It is. It was definitely. And but then there was not many fruiting trees in that particular study area. So we were able to identify, I don't remember on top of my head, I should go back to my papers, but we did identify some of the plants which were found on the edge of the forest. And because we did collect the seeds from the field also. So whatever fruiting plant in the area, we collected and took pictures and gave it to plant botanists so they could identify.
Yes, this is what we found it very difficult. When we had a great jungle for feeding habit, right? When we collected, we have a lot of seeds in there. And fortunately, we contacted Challadurai. You know Challadurai from very good, So we contacted, we are able to identify the seeds. Even I went to French Institute, they said very difficult task to identify the seed. That's what people want.
I agree.
That's what I want to clarify.
Okay.
Thank you
very much. Hi, Deepak. I have a question. This is Sneha here. So from the top of my head, I thought when you mentioned about temperature loggers, I was wondering if you took body temperature of the tortoises to see the thermal ecology.
No, I did not. Mainly because if you if you capture the animal when you're doing a radio telemetry study, you are affecting their behavior by capturing very often.
So right.
That's why we
right.
put a logger on the animal, so we could go and we don't have to disturb the animal very often. That's the reason.
Right. Does this temperature logger also take the body temperature in?
No.
Also take
doesn't.
The body temperature.
No.
Okay.
No.
Right. That would be another interesting study to look, because you are like the data that you showed that you have like the tortoise shutting itself in the cave for 100 days and seeing how the body temperature varies. That would be very interesting thing to look at.
Yeah,
I thought
definitely. Yeah.
And
there are more questions.
Yeah. From Santosh. There is one more before that. Wish you can answer that. Can you tell about your journey to National History Museum?
Journey to National History Museum. After I finished my PhD, which was in 2013, I submitted, but then I finished my PhD in fieldwork in 2010. So after that, I did a postdoc in India. Then that was for another 3-4 years. So when I finished that, I wrote up a grant to come to the museum, Natural History Museum, to study snakes. And I was fortunate and lucky to get a grant to come here and do research on snakes and lizards and, turtles. Yeah.
So the question from Sandosh, except radio transmitter system, how can we differentiate the individual, like, for example, how we differentiate individual tigers with stripes? Is there any differentiation?
So I did not look at it in detail whether there are variation within pattern, but in tortoises, one interesting thing is that you could mark them. So I used to make a small you can saw them on the sides, so they have a fixed number of scutes on the postal region, so on the carapace, so 1 to 9 and 10 to 90. And so like that, you can mark around 9,000 something turtles from a population. So I gave each of those tortoises which I studied, I gave them each of them a number. So every time I had a recapture, I know that was that individual. Yeah.
So next question is from Manoj Shinde. Cane turtle is the only species in its genus. So geographically speaking, how did it end up in southern Western Ghats? Does it have any close relatives in India or Sri Lanka?
So whatever studies have found is that their closest relative is the Melanochelys trijuba. The other common Indian black pond turtle is what is the closest relative. So, and that species is widespread in Sri Lanka and India. So it's not a surprise. So it's just that a species which got better adapted to forest environment. Another thing I forgot to mention during the talk is that this turtle, you can't find them in near water or in water. So they don't like water. They are more in moist conditions, but in evergreen forests. So they are a forest species. So in the same area, you also find the Melanochelys trijuba in some of the ponds, but they do not interact.
So the next question is from Ankita Bhaudari. Thank you for the beautiful insights about the turtle. Were you able to find any evidence of turtles feeding on mushroom? I think you have taken the photo right now.
Yeah, I've taken photo. I've seen them in the field a couple of times.
Next question is Akifa. The hamlets that you mentioned, people living there, were they aware of the Travancore tortoise found there? Or if yes, what were their views?
Oh, they have been living there for a much, much longer time than we know that place as a sanctuary. So there are carders, molluses, and mollusses. There are different tribes there. And they are from this area. They are people who live in the forest. And in the past, they have been hunting small game animals, including Travancore tortoise. So during my study, I did not see anyone catching and eating them. But it is known that people from this region know about this turtle. They also know about the king turtle. Mm-hmm. Actually, in the first graph I showed you, for six decades, nobody knew about it. That's only in scientific records.
Yeah.
So people from the field, they are probably seeing them every day while they were going foraying in the forest. It's just that the rest of the world didn't know.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Next question is from Krishna Murugan. Which is the rarest turtle we can see in India?
I mean, there's two species I can talk about. I can't talk about the rest because I did not do a complete survey of these species. So many species, there is not enough surveys to tell what is their status. So we can proudly say we have so many species in India, but what we know about them is almost nothing for most species, which is very sad. Yeah.
Yeah, I think the next question is the same. I think, have you ever come across scavenging beaver and cane turtle?
Oh, cane turtle. Actually, I did. So I'd seen one cane turtle trying to eat a dead uropelted snake. But then I wasn't sure whether it was a dead uropelted snake which the turtle was trying to feed, or whether the turtle
killed it. Yeah.
So I don't know. It was dead when the animal was trying to eat it. So,
okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Subish?
So I want to tell one more thing about the whole diet and feeding thing. The diet and feeding. It's about the natural history. So that was the figure which I showed at the beginning about the two species and how people didn't find them for six decades. So it's not just that. We have so many reptiles and amphibians in India. For many species were rediscovered in the past two decades. It's mainly because there's hardly anyone going and studying them and looking for these species. And that's one of the reasons that in scientific literature, we don't find these animals, but they were there and they are there, many of them.
Okay. Maybe you can take this as a final question. In future, deploying algorithms, design an artificial intelligence spectra, is it able to conserve turtle ecology in a more precise way?
I think that's as precise as you can get, because we have finally mapped the area and we have looked at their movement pattern and all. Okay, so it's never ending, like, because we had a tough time publishing these things because there were researchers telling us, like reviewers and editors telling us, oh, your sample size is very low, only 5 individual tortoises. So many radio telemetry studies use 100 individuals to get an estimate of home range of the population. So definitely there is a scope to do more studies in future for many more individuals, but you need a lot more resources in order to do this, and manpower to go in field every day and collect this kind of information. And that's going to be a task. But yeah, I'd be more than happy if someone does it, and I'll be happy to share my knowledge on these species, on these two species. Okay.
Sure. So we should
Thank you, Deepak. Thank you for this wonderful session. So I'm still wondering, how did you manage to do a wonderful survey in this terrain? Because seeing that picture, it will be a very difficult task to do the survey of the turtle. And taking it's more interesting to know what this turtle was doing for more than 100 days in a, something like that. I'm still wondering what it was doing all these days. It was a wonderful session. We really enjoyed it, and it's very informative. Thanks a lot.
Thanks
for joining us. Sure.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm very happy.
Thanks, Deepak. Thanks everyone.
See you.
See you. Bye. See you now. Bye.